All right, everybody, good morning. Welcome to The Edge. Hey, I'm so glad you guys decided to come this morning despite the rain, because I know rain just makes me want to sleep, but you guys came to early service, and that's so awesome. We're in our last week of this series called I Want Blank, and I just think this has been an awesome series that we've had. If you haven't been here, week one, we talked about contentment. We looked at the life of a guy named Paul, who, despite being in prison, despite like some of the awful things that were kind of going on in his life, he found contentment in his relationship with Christ and knowing that he could do all things through him. In our second week, we talked about this idea that we all want to be liked. Again, we looked at Paul and we looked at his life before he meets Jesus, before he gives his life to Jesus, right? And he's living his life, right, doing his own thing and basically living for the approval of others, right? And so when he meets Jesus, when he encounters Jesus on the road to Damascus, he gets blinded, gets knocked off his feet, right? His entire life changes and he starts living for Christ and living for other people. And that was week two. Week three, last week, we talked about this idea that we all want to be loved, right? Like, we all have this desire to be loved by people, and that ultimately, right, we can't find our hope in people, we can't find our hope in things or places, but we can find our hope in the God that died for us, that loves us, that wants everything for us through his will, right? And so we talked about Jesus and his ultimate love for us. And so today, we're going to be talking about this idea that I know that we all have felt, and even I have felt like recently, right? Like it's a normal thing to feel. But we're kind of flipping the script a little bit, right? We've been talking about how we want certain things, and today we're talking about what we don't want, and we don't want to be alone. Most of us don't want to be left alone, right, at certain points and certain times in our life. Sure, like alone time is great, and we encourage quiet time and spending that time with God, but we're talking really about the times where we feel completely, totally, and utterly alone in life. So that's what we're going to be looking at today. I'm really excited about this message. I'm glad you guys are here. Let's pray real fast, and we'll jump right into the message, okay? God, we just thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this time and for this moment where we get to be with you. God, despite the rain, Lord, we're so happy to be here, and I'm just so grateful and thankful for everyone in this room right now. God, use me today, move me out of the way, and allow your words to be spoken through me. God, we love you so much, and we thank you. In your name I pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. So most of us, like, we can remember times, like, in our lives when we didn't want to be alone, right? And so, as most of you guys probably know, I'm dating somebody right now named Brittany, and she's got a 4-year-old son named Liam. And so, one thing that Liam really does not like, right, is he does not like falling asleep alone, right? And I can remember and I can think of when I was around his age, right, 4 or 5 years old, where that was like the biggest fear, right? Like, I didn't want to go to sleep by myself, and I certainly didn't want to, like, sleep in my bed, like, by myself, right? Like, it's just kind of like a terrifying thing, right? And so Liam, right, his biggest thing he'll always say is, every time I close my eyes, I see monsters, right? Like, every time, like, he's got a little lisp, it's so funny. Every time I close my eyes, I see monsters, right? And so he's, like, terrified of imaginary monsters. He's, like, terrified of his window. And he's just got this irrational fear, right? And he just doesn't want to be left alone. So one night, I was over at Brittany's, right? We had put Liam to bed, and so I was actually about to leave, right? I'm kind of gathering my things, about to head out the door. And all of a sudden, right, like an earth-shattering scream comes from Liam's room, and like I don't want to replicate it because I'd probably like shatter all the windows in here, right? But he is screaming at the top of his lungs, right? And all of a sudden, his door just like explodes open, and he just like, I don't know if you've ever seen like a toddler run, but they don't really know how to run. He's kind of like running, and he like runs to the living room, and his mom was in her room, and he just busts the door open, and I just see him go like flying through the air, right, to like tackle her and grab her. He had a nightmare, and he was just terrified in that moment. He didn't want to be alone, right? He just wanted to be with mom. And he was just completely mortified, terrified in that moment. And it's funny, right? Because like I look at Liam and I think of that moment, but like some of us, right, hopefully you don't like react the same way, maybe you do, but most of us, right, we get in spots and moments in our life where the thought of being alone is completely and totally terrifying, right? Like it's just totally terrifying. We don't like the idea of it, right? We don't want to spend our lives alone. We don't want to spend our lives alone from family, from friends, maybe a relationship. And sometimes these are things that can really like keep us up at night, right? Like things that really haunt us. And just the thought of being alone. Well, you're not alone in the sense that we all feel this way, right? And the Bible's got a pretty interesting character that felt alone a majority of the time. His name is Jeremiah. And if you don't know much about Jeremiah, Jeremiah is actually known as the weeping prophet. So what Jeremiah did, what God had asked Jeremiah to do, was he was told, right, that you need to go and speak to people about me, right, to talk about that there is a God that loves you, that cares about you, and that if you will confess your sins to God, and if you will follow him and accept him, then your whole life will be changed, right? But the thing about Jeremiah was is that he was really, really good at what he did, but people just were really, really good at not listening to him, right? And so Jeremiah kind of went through his entire ministry life, right? Like preaching to people, telling people about God, and just getting turned down like a whole lot. And it brought a lot of sorrow into Jeremiah's life because he wanted people's lives to change. And I can only imagine maybe at times the insecurity that Jeremiah felt, right? Like always going to people, hey, starting the video back up. Always going to people, always talking to people, but just having people not listen to you. And just the feeling of being alone probably was something that Jeremiah dealt with a whole lot. But none more so do we see this feeling of being alone in Jeremiah's life than we look at this book called Lamentations. Now, most people believe that Jeremiah actually wrote Lamentations. It's not very clear about who wrote Lamentations, but the whole premise behind Lamentations is that it's a collection of poems, basically, that recollects the destroying of the city of Jerusalem. So if you kind of want to go through the Bible and kind of read about that, that's in 2 Kings chapter 24 and 25. But Lamentations is all about the story of how a Babylonian army destroyed Jerusalem. And so Jeremiah lived in Jerusalem at the time, so it's believed that Jeremiah was actually writing this book, Lamentations. And man, it's pretty heart-wrenching to read through this book and imagine, right, like your hometown, the people that you know, your school, like whatever it may be, right, like imagine Bristol, Virginia, right, being completely destroyed by an army, right? And so this is what Jeremiah is going through, and we can kind of see his pain as we read within the first chapter here of Lamentations. It says this in chapter 1, verse 16. It says, "This is why I weep, and my eyes overflow with tears. No one is near to comfort me, no one to restore my spirit." Right? Like, how many of you have felt this way at some point in our life, right? Like, we're in such a deep, grieving state, and we just feel like, man, there is nobody that can possibly help me get out of this mess. There's no one that can possibly make me feel better, right? And with Jeremiah, that might be like quite literally, right? Because, again, his hometown has been destroyed. Like, imagine, he's probably lost friends, he's probably lost family, and so Jeremiah is just in this horrible grieving state. And the interesting thing is that, right, like Jeremiah believes in God, right, he's a Christian, like his whole like purpose on life is to talk about God and talk about how much God loves him, yet he still feels alone. And so it opens up kind of the conversation for us that even though we're Christians, even though we've said, yes, God, I love you, I believe in your son Jesus, I've accepted you into my life, right? We don't have to be following Jesus very long to start feeling alone, right? Like we have certain moments in time where even in our relationship with God that we feel completely alone. Life can be overbearing at times, right? Like life can be very difficult at times. And it's hard to deal with. And it's especially hard when we feel like we are so alone with God. God can feel so far away, and we can feel so alone. Jeremiah continues to say this in Lamentations chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. It says, "The thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words." Right? Like Jeremiah's got that awful taste in his mouth. He cannot seem to look past this moment. He goes on to say that I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Now I'm going to pause here for a minute because I think that Jeremiah kind of offers a unique perspective in this regard when we talk about the fact that he feels like he will never be able to forget this grief that he has. Now, I would say in most situations, right, we go through life and we go through a difficult time, right? And we might hear other people say, like, you just need to forget about it. Like, just forget about it. Just move on from it. You know, it happened. It's over. And I think in certain situations, that's probably a good idea, right? But I want to offer this perspective as well, is that Jeremiah says, I will never forget about this time. I will never forget about this time. And I just want to say this too, that oftentimes I feel like we get in spaces, right, where it's not that we're like forgetting about what happened, but that we're in complete denial of what happened. And sometimes that can be extremely dangerous to our lives, right? And to our lifestyles. Like if something happens, right? If you lose a loved one, if something horrible happens in your life and you're in denial about that happening, right? Like your perspective on life is so skewed and it's so changed. And I want to talk specifically, too, about certain sins that maybe we commit, right? Like, if we're in denial about a sin that maybe we committed, right, we're in denial that what we're doing is bad, then it can completely change, right, the trajectory of where we're going next in our life, if we're in denial about that. And sometimes I think it's so difficult for us, not just when something bad happens to us, but when we're the reason, like, something bad happened to us, right? Like we decided to cheat on the test. Like we decided to go onto that website that we said we'd never go on. Like we decided that we said that thing to a friend that it was a very sensitive time and topic, and we probably shouldn't have gone there, but we went anyway, and we're just in denial about that happening or doing that. Right? Like being in denial can be something that's so destructive for our life, especially with the things that can cause us grief. So Jeremiah is offering that. Even in these times of grief, it's important to, at a certain point in time, when you get to a place where you're getting better, where you're getting over that grief, it's important to look back. Because if we remember the sin, if we remember the thing that we're doing that caused us so much grief, that caused us so much pain, we're going to be less inclined to do it, right? Like, if you touch a hot pan one time, it burns your hand, right? You're not going to go back and touch the hot pan again, right? Like, you don't want to get burned again. So remembering that pain, in a way, I think Jeremiah is offering perspective that can actually help us in our futures and as we continue on with our journey with Christ, right? But I want to offer this perspective as well, because we kind of read through a couple chapters here of Jeremiah, and most of the book, right, there's five chapters in the book, most of the book is filled with this same kind of language, right? Like, just complete and total grief and pain and agony that Jeremiah feels over this whole thing. But I want to offer this perspective as well, because right in the very middle of this book of Lamentations, there is something that is so awesome that we find in his writing. And I want to talk about the middle a little bit, because, like, have you noticed that some of the best things are found in the middle? Like, how many people love Oreos? Like, I love Oreos right now, and I'm on a diet, and I can't eat Oreos, and it's killing me, guys. It's killing me, all right? Different story. But I love Oreos. And why do you love Oreos? The light cream filling, right? Like, it's delicious, right? It's amazing. Like, Bavarian cream donuts. What's the best part? The cream in the middle. Ice cream cake. What's the best part? The ice cream in the middle, which is cookies and cream, which is Oreos. Different story, right? And if we look at the life of Jesus, right, it just seems like Jesus is all about like showing up in the middle, right? Like our timeline is based off of like Jesus' birth, which was year zero, like right in the middle of the timeline. And it just seems like story after story after story, he meets people in the middle of their situation, right? Like he comes to the woman who's caught in the middle of the act of adultery, right? And he saves her from that situation. He saves her from being stoned. He meets people in the middle of their circumstances, like the man who couldn't walk at the pool of Bethesda. He meets the person who's blind at the gate, right? He's in the middle of a circumstance. He's in the middle of a crisis. And we just see time after time after time that God just seems to show up through the entire biblical narrative at some point in the middle. And so it makes sense, right, that kind of wedged in between, right, all this agony and pain and this grief that Jeremiah is having, that he would offer this. And this is in Lamentations 3, verse 21 and 23. Jeremiah says, "Yet I still dare to hope. Yet I still dare to hope." And that phrase alone could set some of y'all free. Like that phrase alone, right? If you woke up every morning with the perspective of, "Yet I still dare to hope. I know I'm going through a hard time. I know I'm struggling right now. I know that life doesn't make sense. I know that my family situation doesn't make sense. Yet I still dare to hope," Jeremiah writes. "When I remember this, the faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning." I'm telling you, if we could wake up every morning knowing that God loves you and that God has forgiven you for your yesterday, man, we could get through the day and get on to our tomorrow, right? Like knowing and believing with everything in us, right, that we can still dare to hope and that his mercies for us begin fresh each day. Jeremiah, in the middle of his pain, in the middle of his struggle, in the middle of trying to figure out what in the world is going on in my life right now, right? Can you imagine the turmoil that Jeremiah is experiencing in this moment? Yet he still writes, "I still dare to hope, and I know that the Lord loves me, and I know that his mercies for me begin anew every morning." And so it brings us to this point, this understanding that when our heart is broken, when our heart is broken, God never leaves you. God never leaves you. When our heart is broken, God never leaves you. In fact, right, I think that when your heart is broken, that's when we seem to feel and sense God even more, right? In the middle of our heartbreak, in the middle of whatever it is you're going through, right, God never leaves you. Now, there's an awesome verse in the Bible that says that God is Alpha and Omega. And so that means that God is A to Z, right? He's A to Z. He's everything in between. And so this kind of interesting perspective, right? If he's A to Z, right, he's at the beginning and he's at the end. This is kind of cool. There's these two verses that I want to read to you. They're the same verse, right? But they're found in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, right? Like they're said by God in the very beginning, and they're said by God towards the very end of the Bible. And this is what it says. In Deuteronomy 31:6 and in Hebrews 13:5, it says, "Never will I leave you, and never will I forsake you. Never will I leave you, and never will I forsake you." How can we know that God always wants to be with us and never wants us to be alone? He says, "Never will I leave you and never will I forsake you." Now, forsake, right? That's an interesting word. And maybe some of you are like, "What does that even mean?" Right? But forsake, "never will I forsake you," literally means that God will never look at you and say, "Man, you're beyond repair." Right? I can't work with this. This is too much baggage. You got too much stuff going on. Man, that's way over my payroll. I'm just going to pass it on to the next God and be good. All right, here's your prescription, there you go, right? But no, God is the master healer, he's the master physician. There is no one, no thing, no condition, no circumstance that he's not concerned about. And what that means is that he will never give up on you. No matter what you're dealing with, no matter what sin you're struggling with, you feel like you can't stop doing a certain thing, you feel like you can't stop texting that guy that you know it's like a bad relationship and you know you shouldn't text him, you know you shouldn't talk to him, but God says, "Never will I forsake you, never will I give up on you. I'm your biggest cheerleader, I'm always rooting for you, I'm always on your side. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. And finally this is what it says in Psalms 34:18. It says that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He's close to the brokenhearted. When you're brokenhearted, God is close to you. God wants to be close to you in those moments. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. And when we're in those spots, when we're in those moments, there's no better time for God to show up. There's no better time for God to move than in those moments. That's when God wants to be close to you. And so even in those moments, even in those times where you may feel alone, where you may feel like, man, what's going on? I don't got it all figured out. I don't know what's going on. I don't know where God is in this. Man, He's right there next to you. I've talked about this before, but I think it's worth re-mentioning, because sometimes I feel like in our lives, right, we're going through the storm, we're going through the waves, we're going through a difficult time, and we want helicopter Jesus, right? And so, if you don't know what I mean when I say helicopter Jesus, I mean like we're in the storm, right? Like imagine like that movie scene where the couple is in the storm, they're in the waters, splashing around, right? And the Coast Guard comes over with the helicopter, right? They drop the ladder down, the people climb up into the helicopter, and they take them off, right? And so sometimes in life, I think that we're in the middle of a circumstance, we're in the middle of a bad situation, and we're like, Jesus, help me! Right? Like, shoot a flare! Right? Like, get me out of this situation, please. Please just get me out of this mess. But yet we stay in the mess, right? Like we stay in the middle of the situation, the circumstance, and it's because Jesus is not a helicopter. Right? The Bible says that we have this sure, steadfast hope for our soul, which is the anchor for our soul. That Jesus actually acts as the anchor for our soul. That we're in this boat and the waves of life are knocking us around, right? Like water's getting in. We're trying to, what in the world do we do? But that anchor is rooted firmly on the bottom of the ocean. And man, an anchor works best when we don't see what it's doing, right? We don't know what it's latched on to. We don't know what it's holding on to, but it's holding on to something, and it works best when we can't see it. And I think that God works in the same way. It works the best when we don't see Him moving. He works the best when we don't know what His plan is. And while He doesn't promise to always take us out of our mess, to take us out of our situation, He always promises that He'll be with us through it. I'm going to get you through it. I know this is hard. I know you're dealing with something. I know you're struggling, but I'm going to be with you through it. And if you'll just hope in me, I've got something really big in store for you. I'm holding on to something big for you. You just get through this storm. You get through this. And just know that I am with you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And I'm holding on to something good. I'm holding on to something else. So as we close out, bands can come back up, and Sydney and Michael, and we're going to sing one more song and head out. But all of you have response cards in your chairs. And so response cards are awesome, because what they allow us to do is that they allow us to pray specifically for you. Like if you are going to do something, if you need prayer for a friend, a family member, whatever it may be, like we want you to use those. We want you to write those down and hand those to us before you go. But today, to kind of help you like with the future, right, like continuing to write those down, I want you to use your response cards today, and I want you to write like in the top right hand corner of that little space to write your response. I want you to just write my lament, L-A-M-E-N-T, my lament. And so what you're going to do is you're going to write your own personal lament, right? Just like Jeremiah did in Lamentations. And so after we're done praying and as we're going through this last song, I just want you to kind of sit and think about, man, like what is it that I'm really hiding? What is it that is really causing me a lot of grief, a lot of pain, a lot of agony? And we want you to write down your lament. And here's the thing, right? If you don't want anyone to see that, you can keep that, you can take that with you, because we feel like it's important for you to just be able to write it out and to see it, because sometimes just seeing something can help you move beyond it, writing it down can help you move beyond it. But if you want to give that to us, right, I'm going to be at the door as you walk out. We're going to have volunteers in the back. But if you want to give that to us, they're completely confidential. We're not going to, you know, post them on Facebook or show them to people, right? But we're going to personally pray over those this week, and we'll be in contact with you. And just saying, hey, we're praying for you. How can we help you? What can we do for you? Because we love you, right? We love you, and we want to make sure that you know that you're cared about, and that that we're always thinking about you. Okay? So I'm going to pray real fast, and after I'm done praying, as we go into the last song, you can take some time to just write down your personal lament. Okay? So everybody, if you just bow your heads, close your eyes, and we'll pray out. And I'm so glad that you guys came today. I love you guys. It's just a, it's a true joy. It's a true joy to be with you all today. So Lord, we just thank you so much for this moment.